Good morning. Good morning from the New Forest. Chris Packham here. Megan McCubbin joining me from our house where we're self-isolating down here. It has previously been sunny. Today it's overcast. And just as a brief weather forecast, I can tell you it remains to be cold. But I did look at the BBC's weather forecast, far more accurate than mine, just before I came out, and it said that it's warming up at the weekend. In the south of England, in some place, London in particular, could get up to 20 degrees. And that will be most welcome because we have run out of heating fuel. So we've been rationing it for the last few days, and we've only had a couple of hours of heat in the evening. And we've been spending most of the day in our rather cold and drafty cottage, dressed in our puffer jackets like this.
What you see us wearing in the morning is literally what we're wearing throughout the day.
Indoors.
Covered in blankets, as many blankets as I can
have. I've got to be honest with you, I woke up really early this morning at 5 o'clock with a stomach ache, which just wouldn't go away. It might have been instigated by the fact that I had a poodle sleeping on me. And I've been awake ever since. When I came out the door, I was feeling a bit of a downer today, if I'm honest with you. I don't know why. It's just one of those things. We don't all get up in the most joyous mood every single day. And then when I came out here to bring things out to the table, I just listened. And all those birds were singing. And I thought, you know what? You're not in a downer. The birds are singing. Just a beautiful sound. And I went for a little walk down the lane, and all the blossoms out, some catkins out, immediately put me in a much better mood.
Feeling better?
Yeah, I am. I genuinely mean that. I came out, I don't know why, I was just, I don't know, moping about a bit. Maybe it was the grey sky, who knows. But anyway, as soon as I saw those catkins, the willow catkins, we'll get some out tomorrow and talk about those.
Did show you the very quick impact that nature can have on
the Yeah, and the birds were singing. I thought, it doesn't matter. You know, everything's just ploughing on.
Everything's just ploughing on. Well, speaking of ploughing on, I'm going to get on with Skull of the Day. Now, we did post a photo on South Islington Bird Club earlier, so you might have already had a good look at it. Take a look at this. And this is a bird that you will see throughout the coast and in inland waters as well. You can see them all throughout the year too. So take a good look at that. Post your comments and your answers and suggestions on South Islington Bird Club, or comments on this feed. And we'll collect all those and get back to you at the end.
Please turn it around and show everyone that, you know, that from the top and bottom.
From the top and the bottom.
That's where the real clue is. Look at the lower mandible, which is on the outside of the upper mandible. And that's really unusual for birds. Normally, the lower mandible fits inside the upper mandible. But here, it's the other way round. Well, why would a bird want its lower jaw bigger than its top jaw?
Good question.
Said jaw, they're not jaws, they're mandibles, but you get the point. Now, if you've been following Spring Watch, The One Show, all sorts of other programs for the last year, you'll know that one of the most exciting reintroduction programs has been taking place down here in our neck of the woods on the Isle of Wight. The wonderful Roy Dennis and the Roy Dennis Wildlife Foundation, helped by his mate and comrade Tim Mackrill, have reintroduced white-tailed eagles to the Isle of Wight. And these birds have been satellite tracked. And if you go to roydennis.org, you can follow the history of these birds, read all about them as a species, and see what's been going on. Now, that was last summer. They released 6 of these birds onto the Isle of Wight. They've been roaming around over the south of England. Lost one of them. The others are still doing fine. But because they're roaming about, there is the chance that you can see them. Now, they've been over the London. They were seen over the Houses of Parliament. So there's virtually anywhere they're going to turn up. But take a look at this, because the other day they turned up at another wonderful institution, the Hawk Conservancy Trust, which is on the A303 down from Andover. Well worth a visit after the lockdown, when we hopefully get back to normal. Fantastic place, lots of conservation work doing there, great educational work, but also no end of enthusiasm. Listen to Ben Cox when he sees the first white-tailed eagle over the Hawk.
We're at the Hawk Conservancy Trust, and we have a wild white-tailed sea eagle. Look at the scenes! It's being mobbed by a wild red kite. This is the first one we've seen. Oh, this is incredible. This is incredible. Oh, white-tailed sea eagle, look at this! Oh my goodness me! It's coming right above us. Wow, wow, wow. Oh, look how big it is compared to the red kite. That's when you know it's an eagle. Look at this. It is literally right above my head right now. It's looking down at me. I can see it. He's looking down at me. Oh my goodness. Look at the attention he's brought with him. He's got a load of buzzards, red kites as well. Wow, wow, wow.
I just love that.
Isn't it amazing?
I love his whooping when he's literally just so excited. He's just going, woo! I bet he was rubbing his trousers. I bet he's rubbed his trousers off. I mean, they were in threads by the time he'd finished.
That is raw enthusiasm, isn't it?
Oh, it was absolutely amazing. Fantastic. It just goes to prove, once these birds are roaming, they are unmistakable. Mm. They call them flying barn doors. You saw the red kite alongside that bird there. There will be no mistaking a white-tailed eagle if one flies over your head. So keep your eyes peeled. That was taken a few days ago. I haven't checked, actually, looking at the satellite tracking, where the birds are at the moment. Certainly some are still on the Isle of Wight, but others could be roaming around. Keep your eyes peeled. And if you are whooping, and if you could out-whoop Ben, then send us your little video.
That's a challenge. Out-whoop Ben. Great. So from one very enthusiastic person to another, we're going to go to our guests today. We are going to go live to Hannah Stitfall, who's going to give you some how-to guides of what you can do at home to help nature in your gardens. You might know Hannah from the Springwatch online platforms. You might also have seen her on BBC Earth.
Hello!
Hi!
Can you hear me?
We can
Yay.
Hear you.
Yay! Hello, good morning, everybody. Yes, I've made the right decision. I'm actually in my house this morning. It's a bit nippy outside. I'm coming to you live from Cornwall with my dog, Isabel. Where is she? Isabel, come here. I'm hoping she doesn't shout at some cats. Here she is. Oh, she's gone camera shy. No doubt she will be popping up in a minute when we get the foodie bits out. And good morning to everyone wherever you are in the country. Down here in Cornwall, spring has definitely sprung. The robins are nesting, the dunnocks are nesting, the garden is full of bumblebees already, and hoverflies, funnily enough. Now, where I live in Newquay, which is right next to the Gannel Estuary, which is a site of special scientific interest, and it's just buzzing with life at the moment. And also, loads of bats. I think I counted 15 pipistrelles last night. Could be wrong because they're pretty tricky to count, but it does seem to be a bumpy year for bats. So let us know in the comments, wherever you are in the country, have you seen any? Have you seen more than usual? And is it just because we're noticing more wildlife because there's less noise pollution, there's less people around, but let us know. And before I get into my fun activities for you, I wanted to share something else very exciting that I found on one of my daily walks. Now, I saw some signs of activity, so I popped up a camera trap and I've come across a very active badger set. Now, I hope you can see this video playing in. Now, this was from night one, and I couldn't believe it when I looked at the camera trap in the morning. It was like Christmas morning. I just couldn't believe that they're just down the road. Now, badgers are mustelids, so they're related to stoats, weasels, polecats, pine martens, and they're largely nocturnal and quite shy. So getting a glimpse of them was a real treat. And they look really healthy. Now, they could be classed as urban badgers, so they're in the middle of the town. And they'll be having a lot of extra food availability. And the reason I know about them is because my mum was putting out apples in her garden for the blackbirds during the winter. And someone was coming and taking them. And I said they were badgers. And this set is right by her house. So very big, very healthy, lots of activity. Then, now this is where it gets interesting. Now, I hope you can see this next video. The second night I put the camera trap up, I got some footage of what looks like four cubs. Very active, very boisterous. Now, Badger cubs will usually be born in February time after the mother's done what is known as delayed implantation. A lot of mammals do this. So she'll give birth when there's more food availability, dependent on her health and dependent on the conditions. Now, me and my badger expert friends, Rosie Woodroff and Dave Hudson, have been looking into this. Now, we've had an incredibly mild winter here in Cornwall, and being urban badgers, they would have had food throughout the year. So we're trying to work out if these are yearlings or they're this year's cubs. It would be unusual, but not unheard of. So we're currently on badger watch down here in Cornwall, and as soon as I find out more information about them, I'm going to be updating you on them. So yeah, just, it's amazing what you can find on one daily dog walk. So there you go. Badgers just down the road. Brilliant stuff. Now, I'm waffling. Let me get into it. When Chris asked me to do one of these, I did think, what if you don't have a garden? What if you don't live in the New Forest? I mean, we can't all be as lucky as that, can we? What if you've just got a balcony? What if you've just got access to a communal area, an allotment? What can you do right now, today, with stuff you've got around the house to start attracting wildlife to you wherever you are? So what we're going to do, and this is just stuff I had around the house. Firstly, we're going to make a solitary bee hotel. Now, you can use a terracotta pot. You can use lots of wood. There's so many online resources to help you make a solitary bee hotel. But what if you don't have a lot of wood lying around? I mean, I don't. This is when, cue an old mug. Now, kids, if you are watching this, please get the mug buyer's permission before using it, because it's going to go outside. So probably best don't use mum and dad's favourite one. We don't want any complaints. Okay, so you've got your mug. Now, solitary bees, different to honeybees and bumblebees that live in these highly developed, super complex colonies. As the name suggests, they're solitary. They don't have a queen. They don't have a hive. They live alone and they don't produce honey. So the females like to lay their eggs for them. So I've got some grass here. And I went out on a foraging mission and I found some stems, some old hogweed stems. My bamboo's going everywhere. So if you have a look at that, see, we've got a little hole in there. And I had some bamboo, which I chopped up. Weirdly, I had some bamboo. I don't know where that's come from. And then all you do, you just pop it in. Just pop it in. There we go. And the key here, I hope you can see this. And the key here is to make sure it's really well stacked and that your nest cavities aren't moving around. Because what the girls will do, they'll come in and they'll lay the egg right at the bottom of the nest cavity. And then they'll go out and collect pollen and nectar to make a kind of pollen cake, I guess that's what you call it. Yeah, it's a pollen cake. And they'll lay the pollen cake right at the end next to the egg, ready. And so I'll keep stacking this in. So make sure there's not a lot of movement because they don't like that. And if they're a red mason bee, then they will come and block up the entrance to the cavity with some mud. But if they're a leaf cutter bee, they will make a type of leaf paste to block the entrance up with. And hang on, this isn't really working. I tell you what, look, here's one I made earlier. Look at that, that's lovely, isn't it? So if it's a leaf cutter bee, she'll come and block the entrance up with some leaves, and they really love roses. They also like birch, wisteria, but rose bushes are one of their favourites. And there's a species called Francis E. Lester, correct me if I've got that wrong, but that is one of their favourites. So if you are making one of these to put out on a balcony or something, get yourself a little rose bush, because the leaves are really easy for them to cut through and make their paste. Now look how quick and easy that was. That one, I'll finish that in a minute. But that, super easy. You can do that today. All you got to get is some hollow stems and some bamboo. But the key is don't hang these up, because otherwise they'll wobble in the wind. It's like the bees are on a constant roller coaster. Nobody wants that when they're eating. So what you've got to do, place it on the ground, preferably a little bit off the ground, somewhere that gets the morning sunshine, because they really, really like that. And there you go. Super quick, super easy. You can do that today. And look, it may not look the most exotic bee hotel, but you'd be surprised how quickly they actually come. I made one of these and I put it in my garden. Within 5 days, we had red masons using it. So there you go. Quick, easy, done. Now, we get asked an awful lot how to attract birds to the garden. Well, birds are just like us. They like anything highly calorific. So, Q, some lard balls. Now, homemade. Now, this is going to get a bit messy. You are going to need a cloth, but this is super easy. And you can do this if you only have a balcony. What you do, right, I'm going to have to do this. Hang on. Right, you've got to get your lard. This is going to get really messy. I'm sorry. Get your lard. Make sure it's room temperature so you can easily chop it into bits. There we go. And these are great for goldfinches, blue tits. Hang on, I'll move my string. Put that in there. There we go. Now, great for goldfinches, blue tits, great tits. Everything loves these. Now, you can use bird seed. You can use raisins. You can use all sorts of things. Now, I've only got sunflower hearts because I accidentally ordered 2 bag loads enough to feed all the birds in Cornwall for the next millennia. But they like sunflower hearts, so that's absolutely fine. And then pop your sunflower hearts in, like so, or whatever you've got. Now, these are really, really good. And we've had a woodpecker on ours. So there you go. It's going to get really messy. There we go. So pop that, mix it all together. Then all you do, hang on, I haven't done this live before, you can probably tell. So you get your bit of string, there we go. You make a little hole in the middle, pop your string in, like so, and voila. See, it's not gonna go up because what you then need to do, you need to put them in your fridge to set for an hour or overnight. So you'll be pleased again to know, hang on, where's my cloth? You'll be pleased again to know, here's some I made earlier. Well, actually, I made these last night and they've been setting in my fridge overnight. So I really hope these are going to work because I haven't tried them yet. So let's see. First time. Voila! Look at that. There you go. So there you have your homemade fat ball for birds that everybody will love. Highly calorific. And we always get asked if we should still feed the birds in spring. And yes, absolutely. You know, this is when they're breeding or they're hatching their young. So anything like this, you can hang this on a balcony. Oh, see, here's the dog. I told you Isabel would come over when I got the lard out. And here she is. No, you can't eat. Hello, darling. Hello, hello. No, I know. I know you want to eat this. Hey, these aren't for you. They're for the garden birds. Let me put these down here. So there you have it. 2 super quick, super easy things you can do at home today with stuff you just have around the house. What are you eating? She's eating the sunflower hearts off the floor. Isabel, darling, come on. We'll go out in a minute. We're nearly done. So that's it. So if you do homemade anything that, well, I've shown you today, it will definitely be better than mine, no doubt. Please do send us in your photos because we'd love to see your craft work. And yeah, give them a go. No, don't lick my hands. Now, just before I go, quickly, on one of my morning foragers, she's gone mad. I found, obviously it's spring and the birds are hatching. Look, she can't stop licking my hands, stop it. And I found, obviously the birds are hatching now, I found this eggshell. Now it got a bit battered in my bag, to be honest. But can you guess what it is? Pure white, glossy, I think there should be a picture as well, about 33 millimetres by 22 millimetres. What do you think it could be? I think I could hazard a guess.
Hello, sorry.
Hello, Hannah. Yes. Hi. Well, that's fantastic. I love the canine involvement, of course, the guard hound.
I'm glad to say that we're not the only ones with naughty canines.
It's not an endangered breed, the Cornish lard hound, quite obviously. Not sure sunflower hearts are going to be that nutritious. But the egg that you found is, yeah, it's a wood pigeon. And we know that because of the shiny, as you say, and glossy covering. Has it been split almost clean in two?
Pretty much. It's got battered from my bag, though. But it was pretty straight down the middle, yeah. Mm-hmm.
Well, that's an indication that that egg has hatched successfully. Though obviously, sometimes we find eggshells that have been predated by things like crows and magpies or wood mice and rats, etc. And they, if they've been... been broken open and then that means that the young bird has twisted around inside the egg using a tiny little thorn-like appendage on its beak called the egg tooth, and it cuts around the inside of the egg, opening it very neatly so that it pops open like this into exhibit A and exhibit B, and you've got exhibit A there, the other half is somewhere else. And then the adult birds will then carry them away from the nest and drop them so that they don't fall to the ground beneath the nest and therefore attract predators to the fact that there were young birds there. So yeah, that's a healthy wood pigeon hatched egg. Fantastic.
And lots of people were getting that right. Lots of people were commenting saying wood pigeon as well. So well done all those people that have done that. Hannah, there's been loads of amazing comments. People said that watching you is like watching Blue Peter.
Well, we do. The lard hound's back. He's here. I'm going to have to move all of this in a minute. Well, you know, we aim to please here in Cornwall, me and the lard hound. And do send in your photos. Also, if you are looking for more information about solitary bees, my friends Green and Blue here in Cornwall, they actually make solitary bee bricks and they let me use their photographs for this. So go and check them out. They're absolutely amazing. And I mean, I'm happy to do another Blue Peter set, but maybe more food. Would you like that, Isabel? You'd love that, wouldn't you?
I'm sure she would. Well, thank you so much for joining
Thanks,
us, Hannah.
You've
lovely to see you both. Take care. See you soon.
See you soon.
It's about 2:30 in the afternoon. You can hear some music behind me. Well, what some people might call music. But something very rare is happening here. Something quite extraordinary. Let's see if we can see what it is.
By just putting WUP, I thought you wouldn't get it, but clearly.
You know, I love the fact that I've managed to make washing up competitive. Because do you know what that means? It means that someone quite close to me might be doing a little bit more of it.
Trying
to keep up.
No, trying to keep. Are you kidding me? I do so much washing up. I also do all the cooking. And for those people asking, I've had a comment come through saying, Chris, what's your stomach ache this morning due to the fact that you cooked last night? Well, I have to be honest with you. It got to about 7 o'clock last night. And I said, so, Chris, what are we having for dinner? And he just looked at me and he said, oh. And I was like, do you want me to cook? And his words were, well, it would be easier, wouldn't it? So I guess you had to cook again.
I think we better draw this conversation to a conclusion.
Yes, we'll go on.
Chris Packham Car Valeting Services won't be cleaning your car as they promised to do yesterday afternoon.
Only when you were cleaning your own car. You're making me sound like I'm awful.
Okay. Now, whilst we've been on Make and Do, a couple of years ago, whilst we were making Spring Watch, we were giving people ideas of things that they could do very simply, very easily, and very quickly in their own garden. And one of those, we have mentioned this already, was making a very small pond out of a washing up bowl. A washing up bowl.
Washing up?
Bowl. It's not something you're familiar with, Megs, but you'll see one in a moment, because I took one down to the producers at that time, Chris and Laura Howard's garden in Bristol, and we made a short 2-minute piece of me sinking this into the ground. So we're going to show you that first, and then we're going to go live over to Chris and Laura, who are going to give us an update as to what's been happening with that very modest but very effective little pond. So here's me making it, and then we'll go straight to Chris and Laura down in Bristol.
This is a Winter Watch SOS. Yes, every month for the next year, we're going to show you something that you can do in your garden that will improve it for wildlife. So to get started, a pond from an old washing up bowl. If it still holds water, it can hold life. Where's Conan the Barbarian when you need him? He put some ponds in. Oh, I say, that's almost a perfect fit. It's remarkable. Ideally in a pond, you want a sloping side. So the quickest way to do that is to use some pebbles. Get it started by putting some plants in. You can get these at garden centres, and these are aquatic plants, very obviously. I'm going to leave them in the pots for the time being. Even a tiny pond like this one is singularly the most effective resource to increase the value of your garden to wildlife. There, I've tickled the fancy of a tadpole. I've made a newt happy. And if you can get a damselfly or a dragonfly dreaming by making a mini pond of your own, then we would like to see it. Send pictures to us. Twitter, Instagram, Facebook, all under the title of BBC Springwatch. Now, go to it. Save our species.
Oh, really? Sorry, we're having some technical difficulties. That's the phrase, isn't it? We have some technical difficulties with the sound down with Chris and Laura. We're going to try and fix that and get back to you with them as soon as we possibly can. So Fabian Harrison, in his bedroom in Norwich, is doing everything he can with some very simple software that he's got on his laptop, which we are hopefully upgrading today to get a more powerful device. And hopefully we can overcome some of these technical things. But we'll fill in for the meantime.
So we're going to fill in with a little bit of audience Q&A, a bit of audience interaction from you guys. So there's been some lovely things coming in. There has been a question, Chris, from Jonathan on Twitter. See if you know the answer to this one. Do they get bats on the Isle of Harris?
I imagine they would. I mean, there are not many trees on the Isle of Harris. That's to be on that west side of Scotland, you know, certainly on the western side of Harris. But of course, yeah, I mean, I imagine they would have pips up there, undoubtedly. Some of the species of bat we have in the UK are more southerly focused because it is a bit warmer and a bit closer to the continent. Bat distribution isn't terribly well. Well, that's not fair. That's not fair. Bat distribution is well known, but not as well known as it is with birds. They are an animal that's more difficult to census because they're difficult to identify in flight without a lot of expertise. We are developing the technology to be able to remote record bats and therefore map them a little bit more accurately. I have to say, I've enjoyed great birding on the Isle of Harris. Great times on the Isle of Harris, to be quite honest with you. Excellent art exhibition that I went to there once. Absolutely fantastic. But I've never been batting there. So I think what we should do is get back to you tomorrow with a bat update, how many species you find on the Isle of Harris. I bet you get Dorbentons. I bet you get pipistrelles. I wouldn't be surprised if you don't get noctule. They're a big bat, so they could probably do well further north.
I would have thought, but things like tawny owls and things, they don't like to fly over open water, so you don't get them on even like the Isle of Wight or things like that. But with bats, they are more heavily distributed. They're not so bad at coming in over water, partly because we brought them over onto those kind of islands. So you do tend to get bats over there. But
we'll get back to you on that one tomorrow.
Oh, no. You did it. You went there. Lots of people are seeing bats during the daytime.
Yeah, they are. I mean, at this time of year, it's been hot, it's been cold. The bats are waking up from hibernation. They're beginning to move around. And sometimes they'll move from roost to roost in the sense that they will emerge from one and then they will fly to another. If they lose it or if they get caught short or if that roost has been disturbed or destroyed, then the bats gets a little bit lost and sometimes you'll see them in the daytime. That's not atypical for spring and autumn.
So Amanda Coleman says, good morning. I was happy to find out today that otters have been spotted at the River Dawn in our village of Golden Valley, Hertfordshire. My heart skipped a beat.
Yeah, fantastic. Otters.
Amazing.
You know, they, in the last century, let's go back. Pre to the 1900s, there was a lot of dumping of chemicals into our waterways and many of them were almost devoid of life. They were depleted of all life. And of course, that damaged the ecosystems there and everything at the top of the food chain just disappeared. And otters really only occurred on the western side of the UK. Wales was a stronghold, of course. Cornwall and Devon was a stronghold and Scotland, away from those industrial areas. Then post-war, we had the pesticide crisis. Through this, otter hunting was still going on, although it was diminishing quite rapidly, so that wasn't impacting on the population. But put it this way, you know, when I was a kid way back in the 1960s, otters were a relatively rare animal, difficult to see, certainly didn't really occur in Hampshire where I was growing up. They have now recovered their range. Otters have been found in every UK county, including Kent. They've gone all the way back from the west right across to Kent, but they haven't recovered their numbers. They're not at what we call carrying capacity. So there is still scope for more otters to exist in our environment, particularly now when we've cleaned it up and our waterways are so much more healthy than they were. So we can't be complacent about otter conservation just because they're back everywhere. They're not back in the numbers that they were. But it's great to see them turning up. And in some places, they're turning up in urban areas. I know that in Andover, in Salisbury, in Blandford, these are sites that are close to us down here in the south of England. You can see them in daytime from footpaths and in one of those sites from a footpath that runs along the edge of a supermarket. So otters, having been an enigma when I was younger, have come back now and they are more accessible to naturalists.
So exciting to go out and see an otter on your walk over a foot. I mean, that's just the best, isn't it?
Well, yeah. I mean, I think it's the Sainsbury's in Salisbury. Sainsbury's in Andover. where there's a path that runs alongside the river there. And whilst you're pushing your trolley, you can look over the side and people frequently see otters.
Amazing.
And at Blandford on the river there, for a long time, I don't know about, you know, the last couple of years, there were always otters that were really visible there, and people would see them whilst they're walking their dogs. So again, you know, that's a good sign. But there are parts of the country, very sadly, where, you know, they are few and far between and haven't got their numbers back yet.
So unfortunately, I've just got a message from Fabian come through, and we've had to cut Laura Howard and Chris Howard out for today just because of those technical issues. What we'll do is we'll try and bring them back to give you an update on that pond very, very soon. So I'm going to continue with a little bit more Q&A from you guys. Yesterday, we got sent in the most adorable video of two little fox cubs. Now, it's quite early to see fox cubs out and about. However, there have been very early sightings. I think Yolo Williams saw one in January, which is quite unusual.
Yes, very unusual. It's normally April before we get to see our fox cubs, but this year there were not just Yolo, but there were a number of other reports of very small cubs being out. I think one even before Christmas.
So that was sent to us by Terry Hancock. I mean, they're a great little thing when you see them come out of their little. Oh my God, they're just so cute. They're very cat-like when they're young. Aren't they? They just don't look quite. They're canines, but they don't look
short ears. And, you know, yeah, they do look more like when they first come out, there's like sort of milk chocolate brown and they're blunt little noses. They certainly look more like kittens than dogs. So of course, as soon as that nose starts to grow, then they become more canid than fellid.
Gorgeous animals. So that was a great, great clip. Thank you, Terry, for sending that in to us. Second photo that I pulled out was from Marionville. Now, this is a photograph of goldfinches. This is something you guys can do at home. So this goldfinch is hanging on a bird feeder in Marion's garden. And what she's done is she's filled that bird feeder with her cat hair. So she's groomed her cat, stuffed it all in that bird feeder, and that goldfinch is taking out the fur and it's going to take it away to use in its nest. So that's a really valuable resource. Cat fur is really insulating. All your pet fur is really insulating. So if you have animal that can be groomed, maybe leave the hair out for the birds that are frantically trying to build their nests and breed successfully at the moment. So
goldfinch nests are really soft little affairs as well. They're tiny. They're about the size of my fist and they have a tiny little cup in them, and they frequently use sheep's wool. I've seen them using synthetic wool that they pulled out of old, you know, mattresses and things like that as well. But they do make a very soft and also flexible nest. And I know we've spoken about the flexible nature. Yolo yesterday talking about a long-tailed tit's nest being like lycra, so it can expand when the young are growing in that nest. And it's pretty much the same with goldfinches. They have got a nest which is flexible, thanks to all of that soft material. But fantastic to see that. Worth putting. I mean, we could groom the poodles, but no hair comes out.
No, they don't molt.
That's one of the benefits you see. That was, you know, that means that we don't have to use something else, Megs. It's called a it's called a vacuum cleaner. Vacuum cleaner. Now in the house there's a cupboard, right? And if you open the door and you look in, there's this weird thing. It's like a tube comes out of it, right? Like a brush attachment on it.
I'm not even going to justify it with a response, you know. I'm just going to move swiftly on because it's utter rubbish.
Tomorrow we have Bella Lack, the young wildlife campaigner, coming on to join us. We've been reaching out to younger people. We're very conscious of the fact that we haven't had too many of them on our little broadcast yet. So we're reaching out to them. Very pleased that Bella is going to be joining us live tomorrow morning.
She's going to be talking all about youth engagement as well. So that's going to be a great thing to tune into. I'm going to round it up now with the answer to skull of the day. Have a look at this again. If you didn't see it earlier, take a good look. I'm just seeing if we've got anyone that's come in.
You hold the skull.
So I can't see if anyone's got this right. I haven't got anything coming through, but I'm sure lots of you did. So this is the skull of a cormorant. Now you'll see them, as I said earlier, in coastal areas and inland waters as well. And as Chris said earlier, this mandible, the lower mandible, is on top of the top mandible, which is something very unusual. It's much bigger. And that means when the bird opens its mouth, its gape is huge. And that's because cormorants catch their fish, this beak on the bill, and they catch their fish, they grip it. This bill is predominantly for gripping. It's not very strong. And then what they do is they swallow the fish whole. Now, sometimes you'll see cormorants and they'll catch a fish and it will look impossible for them to swallow because it just simply looks too big. But because of this mandible, because of that really wide gape when they open their bills, they're able to swallow the fish whole. And now a very charismatic thing about the cormorant, if you're on the coast, you might see them, and you'll see them with their wings spread out like this. So what they're doing is they're drying off. Cormorants don't actually have waterproof feathers. It helps them with their depth. They're able to dive to deeper depths because they don't have this waterproof coating, aids them in their buoyancy. So they come up and they dry their wings off like this, but it also has a very important function as well. It warms the blood in those wings. That blood then gets circulated through the body to the digestive system and the stomach, and it helps them digest those large fish more efficiently as well, which I think is pretty spectacular.
Pretty cool.
Pretty cool.
Now, we normally finish with a slow-mo of poodles.
We do, but considering the sunflower canine that we had on earlier
with Hannah. The Cornish lard hound.
That we had on earlier with Hannah. Her name is Isabel, and we thought we'd give you a slow-mo of a guest canine instead. So enjoy this, and we'll see you tomorrow. Bye.
Bye-bye.